stand with me tonight. And I know you're probably weary from the time change, hard to get over it. But I want to begin reading here in Matthew 24, that in verse 32, and we'll read some verses. We're going to preach tonight, the Lord will help us, on the rapture. Amen. The Bible said, "Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, you know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when you shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. But of that day and that hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Then shall be two in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, the one shall be taken and the other left. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come." Father, I thank you for the word of God and for the safety to come here and be this wonderful church and for this tremendous man of God. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing here. And I just thank you for it, God, to hear the excitement of what's taking place and the addition to the property here and the addition to the parking spaces. What a blessing to see this. And God, to start a meeting tonight and to have people come out on a dreary night. What a blessing. And God, we do agree with the prayer the brother prayed, that there'll be souls saved before these days are over and lives changed and touched by the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the privilege we have to be here. What an honor it is. What a privilege it is. Thank you, God, for allowing us, Lord, to carry the word of God and to preach the gospel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Thank you for that. And God will thank you, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And you can be seated tonight. Thank you. And I appreciate your attention tonight. I want to say tonight, beloved, that Matthew 24 is misunderstood by a lot of folks simply for one reason, I believe, and that is because it is not given, the prophetic scenarios in Matthew 24 are not given to us in chronological order. They're not given to us in the order that they're going to take place. And so that's caused people to have a lot of problem with Matthew 24. We begin reading here tonight in verse, you'll notice that we read there in verse number 32, that is the rapture. But when you back up and notice that in verse 27, you have his revelation given before his rapture. Now the revelation is when Jesus will come back to this earth with the saints of God. The rapture, he comes to this earth for the saints of God. So the second coming of Jesus is in two great stages, or two theaters, that he'll come in the rapture, in the air, in the clouds, for the church, his bride, praise God. And then after the end of the tribulation period, we'll come back to earth with him, and we'll watch Jesus defeat the Antichrist and the false prophet and the armies gathered at Armageddon, praise God. But I'll tell you something tonight. I may not have everything right on prophecy, but I love that in Thessalonians where it says, when the rapture takes place, so shall you ever be with the Lord. Amen. And if I'm with him, it'll be all right. Praise God. If we get something wrong, I'll tell you, I guarantee you, I'll be with Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now, Matthew 24 is the greatest single prophetic chapter in the Bible. And we could spend easily all four nights here and not exhaust these verses in this great chapter. And it started out with Jesus with his disciples observing Herod's temple. Herod's temple was one of the wonders of the ancient world. It was an international tourist attraction there in Israel, within the Roman Empire. And people who wanted to see the great and important sites of the world of that day had on their list Herod's temple. Even though they could not go in that temple being Gentiles, they wanted to see it. It was a magnificent. And the Jews believed that when the remodeling would be finished of Herod's temple, that it would signal the beginning of the renewal of Israel to be to rule the world. And in essence, they were looking for a millennial reign when that temple was completed. But you know what Jesus said when he looked at that temple? He said, I tell you that not one stone will be left upon the other. And it shocked the disciples. So they went to him and said, tell us, when shall these things be, and the signs of thy coming, and the end of the world? And Jesus then begins to give them the Mount Olive Discourse, Matthew 24. This is found also in Luke 21. It's also in the Gospel of Mark in some variations. But we have Matthew 24 is the most complete, I think, of the giving of the... And so he begins to talk about what will happen. Now, the destruction of the temple and the three areas that he deals with. And I want you to notice with me in verse number 4 that we have a very important statement that the Lord gives. And there in verse 8 of Matthew 24, he talks about, in verse 8, all of these are... You should underline this in your Bible. The beginning of sorrows. The beginning of sorrows. This is comparing the rapture of the church to a woman delivering a baby. The beginning of sorrows are the birth pains. I believe this is what Paul had in mind in Romans chapter 8 and verse 22. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together even until now. Now, birth pains do two things, as you mothers know. As a child is coming into the world, those pains become more severe and they become more frequent. You and I are victims of prophecy. We are living. You remember when Jesus told the people of his day and he said, many have lived and died and have desired to see the sights and see the signs that you're seeing fulfilled, and they died not seeing those sights. You remember that? Do you realize, folks, that you and I are in the same kind of generation? If the Lord could come today and speak to us tonight, he would say to us the same thing. There has been many believers in the last almost 2,000 years of Christian history that have longed to see the things that you are seeing, and they died not seeing those things. What about that? When premillennialism, by the way, I hope you understand the difference in premillennial, postmillennial, and amillennial. A lot of times, Brother Jim, we take for granted people know all these terms and understand these things. And sometimes I try to slow down and just say, now, when we talk about being premillennial, the word millennial means 1,000. And he's talking about the 1,000-year reign upon the earth. There was a preacher went into the mountains of Kentucky, and he started preaching on a 1,000-year reign, 1,000-year reign, 1,000-year reign. And the farmers met him one night and said, preacher, we love you, but listen, if it rains 1,000 years, it's going to wash everything in this country away. Amen. We're worried about that 1,000-year reign. But Jesus is going to reign 1,000 years. Amen. And when we say that we believe in a pre-millennial reign, pre-millennial coming of Christ, we believe that he comes back before his 1,000-year reign. Amen. Now, pre-millennial Christians take the Bible literal. That's right. We believe when it says a white horse, he means a white horse. When he talks about the Jews being saved, it means the Jews. Jerusalem being restored, those things will literally be fulfilled And then you have what is called post-millennialism. Now, this became very popular in the 1800s, in the heyday maybe of Christianity, when post-millennialism says, we believe that Jesus will reign 1,000 years, and after his 1,000-year reign, he'll come back post or after his millennium. And they generally hold to what is called replacement theology. How many's familiar with replacement theology? Just a few people. Replacement theology has become very popular in these days, and it says that the church has replaced the nation Israel in Bible prophecy. It's a very great error and a false doctrine to embrace replacement theology. So, and by the way, I'm so strong a premillennialist, I won't even buy Post Toasties at the store. Amen. Then there is amillennialism. Now, the amillennialists, I don't know if you have them here, but we got them in the mountains where I live. And every amillennial preacher I know preaches, he hacks when he preaches. Amen. You ever heard a preacher hack? Mr. Friend. Boy, they'll hack when they preach. And they don't believe anything. Amen. They don't believe in a rapture. They don't believe in a 1,000-year reign. They don't believe in a judgment seat of Christ and a white throne judgment bar. They preach what's called general resurrection, general resurrection, and general judgment doctrine. What is that? A general resurrection is that Jesus comes back and will resurrect the lost and the saved together, and then he will judge who is saved and who is lost. And the saved go with him to heaven, the lost go to hell. That's the end of the story. They take that a lot from Matthew 25, which we know is the judgment of the nations when Jesus comes back. If you study Matthew 25, you'll find very clearly the Bible is talking about the king separating the sheep. That's when he comes back. The people that are left alive at the end of Armageddon when Jesus comes back, he does judge them and separate them. But it is not talking about a general resurrection of the lost and the saved and a general judgment of the lost and the saved. That is a false doctrine. That's part of amillennialism. So those are the positions that you have. Thank God you're in a church that believes in premillennialism. Amen. A preacher that believes the Bible. A church that believes the Word of God. Now, there's a lot I want to give you tonight, so I'm going to preach fast, and I want you to listen fast, okay? And let's look at the rapture. First of all, the explanation of the rapture. What is the rapture? I'm aware the word rapture is not found in our King James Bible, but certainly the concept is the snatching away of the church. There are two very important scriptures that we need to consider on this point. The first would be in 1 Corinthians chapter number 15 and verse 51. Turn there, please, in your Bible with me. These are wonderful scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I got word this morning as I was coming here that a lady that I pastored 35 years ago died this morning and played the piano in the church and helped us start a church in 1982 in a little town in East Tennessee. I had a lot of years of pastoring her. And boy, I thought about what a blessing it is, a hope we have tonight in the Lord. Amen. And Paul is writing here, and he said in 1 Corinthians 15, 51, he said, behold, I show you a mystery. A mystery is a great truth that has not yet been disclosed by God. And there are several mysteries in the New Testament. This is one of them. He said, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Somebody said that's a good verse to put on the nursery of the church right there. Amen. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality. Then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And I love verse 58. Well, if you don't get anything else tonight, friend, carry this home with you. Put this in your heart tonight. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. I'll tell you, it's wonderful to be saved. Right. Amen. I've never had fooled with the internet or anything much. I still can't do anything with a computer. Kind of learned how to use a smartphone a little bit. And I went ahead and did a Facebook page. Huh? I preached against it. And I guess I'm a hypocrite now. I've got that thing. I've preached against that mess. Here I'm doing it. But I got a lady sent me a message in the Philippines. And she said, I believe in 1994 you baptized me. 1994. And I wrote her back and I said, I was with Arnold Tangub and I baptized in a swimming pool. I remember the first trip I made to the Philippines, 1994. About 23 years ago or so, that woman said, you've been a great part of my Christian life and I'm still serving God. Somebody said, these people really get saved on the mission field. Hey, friend, listen. They don't only get, not only they get saved on the mission field, they're outdoing us here in America, amen? And you people get critical about what's going on the mission field. They need to go and see it like your preacher did, and you come back with a different perspective of what God's doing. Our labor is not in vain in the Lord, amen? And then I had a guy contact me that said, in going back further than that, when I was a United Methodist, preaching revivals, winning people to God. And he said, Brother Dewey, I got saved as an 8-year-old boy back in the 70s when you held a revival meeting at Kendricks Creek Methodist Church. And he still had the revival flyer and sent it to me. Man, I got so blessed. Amen. He said, I'll never forget getting saved. Praise God. Let me tell you, friend, what we do is not in vain tonight in the Lord. Praise God. Now, go with me to Thessalonians, and I want to show you some things here. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and this is the second real important scripture and text concerning the rapture of the church. Probably the most important and the most used and most familiar text is this one. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and verse 13. This is what I use at a committal service when we commit their body to the ground. I like to always use this scripture. If it's a believer, I won't if I'm not sure they're saved. Amen. Amen. I got a friend of mine over home. His name's Bobby Stout. Brother Bobby Stout, back in 1964, you know Bobby? Yeah. He's a blessing. He's bad shape now. 1964, he went to a little school in the mountains of northeast Tennessee called Hampton, right close to the North Carolina line. Buck Van Huss was the coach, famous coach there. Took those boys to Memphis. I bet it took 15 hours to go to Memphis in those days. And there wasn't any classification. And you know Hampton won the state championship. They could have made a movie, been like Hoosiers. It'd been better with them hillbillies, though, I'll tell you that, amen? Huh? So Brother Bobby Stout, I love his story. He preaches the funeral of Coach Buck Van Huss, his famous coach. One of his teammates comes up to him. He said, Bobby, oh, you did a great job. And I want you to preach my funeral. And Bobby said, now look here, buddy. you're going to have to give me something to work with. You know what? Tonight, our goal ought to be, as Christians and church members, when the Lord takes you home, you give your preacher something to work with. Amen. Say amen, church. Amen. Praise God. That's right. You give him something to work with. Now, I want you to notice this. He said, I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren. 1 Thessalonians 4:13. Concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not even as others which have no hope. For if we believe it, Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent. The word prevent there means precede. Shall not prevent or precede them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Amen. Now I want you to notice, please, that this is a tremendous promise of what is going to happen in the rapture. The Lord himself is going to come. And when Jesus comes, think about this tonight, folks, that when you and I die and you're a believer, the Bible tells us if we're absent from the body, we're what? Present with the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? Praise God. Well, why doesn't our body go to be with the Lord? Huh? That's not talking about our body, soul, and spirit. It's talking about our soul and spirit, right? And so, I don't know about this part of the country, but down home, I think it's everywhere. I think it's a typical thing to say concerning a dead person, to call that person his or her remains. Y'all do that in New York? That's an interesting word. There is John Smith's remains. Fellow over there in the mountains, done like your brother, went down to Florida. Over there, you know, and it's for this winter time. And while he's down there, he's a couple months down there, and he died. And boy, I mean, he'd lost some weight. He'd got a good suntan, and they brought him back, and they was viewing the body, and they said, you know, that 2 months down there done him a world of good. Said, I've never seen him look so good. Now, if we call a body someone's remains, what does that say? That means that something had to leave. And that's what remains. That makes sense? So what left? Soul and body. And you want to know why? Because when God saved us, the Holy Spirit of God came within us and regenerated us and made our soul and our body 100% heaven ready the moment we got saved. Justification results in regeneration. Regeneration, you are recreated, made eternal and perfect. And I have a part of me that's eternal and perfect. It's heaven ready, amen. It's 100% heaven ready. And if I die and don't make it home back to the mountains of Virginia, it's all right. I'll be with the Lord. See? Now, what happens at the rapture, folks, remember this, is when the rapture takes place, it also is the first resurrection. And we are going to see at the rapture two great things happen. First of all, the dead in Christ, their bodies are going to be resurrected. God is going to resurrect the bodies. I say a lot of times at a funeral, I say, you know what? I don't like to call this a casket. I like to call it a hope chest. God is not through with this body. This is the body of a believer. It's the remains of a child of God. And God still has a claim on this body. And we're burying this body in the hope of the resurrection. Right? Is that not Christianity? So, that body will be resurrected and glorified. And when you're glorified, if you'll go to me with Philippians chapter 3. I love these verses too. Verse 20 and 21. This is a wonderful promise for our conversation. The word conversation in our King James Bible, in every other case, means manner of living, the way you live. Here it means citizenship. For our conversation or our citizenship is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our, what kind of body? What's it? What's the word, folks? Vile. That word sounds bad, doesn't it? Who will change? You said, that's not my body. That's yours and it's mine. Dr. Wilmington, remember what he used to say, Brother Jim? Everybody's made out of the same mold, just some are molier than others. Amen. Our bodies are vile. The body I live in is absolutely sorry. I have to die to it every day, and it comes back every day. It comes back. It doesn't want to do God's will. It doesn't want to pray. It doesn't want to read and study and witness. It doesn't want to deny itself. It doesn't listen. But he's going to change our vile body that it may be fashioned like unto what? His what? Glorious body, according to the working wherewith he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. When the rapture takes place, the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together, and we're going to be changed without death. Amen. And we will be the first people on earth who will be able to say, oh death, where is thy victory? Our generation, you said we're going to be in the rapture? I can't say that, but I can say this. We have a better chance than anyone who's ever lived to be in the rapture. Praise God. And we will be able to cheat the undertaker at that day. And we will be changed without death. What a blessing. Amen. Now, number two, I want to talk to you a minute about the events leading up to the rapture. Go back to Matthew 24 and let's notice what Jesus said. He gives some things here, some signs that leads us up to the rapture. Remember we talked about that there would be the beginning of sorrows. This would be a time, a countdown to the rapture. Now no one knows the day or the hour of the rapture. And anyone who says they do, they're a liar. In fact, I don't even understand it. But the Lord Jesus Christ said that only my Father knows. The angels don't know. And he even said he didn't know. Explain that. He's omnipotent. He's all-knowing. He's omnipotent. He's all-powerful. But you know what he has done? He has rescinded the knowledge of the exact time of the rapture entirely to his Father, waiting on the word from his Father to go and get your bride. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Now, they ask, when shall these things be? In verse 3. And the rapture is then compared to a woman giving birth, as we mentioned. And notice then that in verse 4 and 5, the Bible says we'll move into a time where there'll be an increase in deception, false religion, cults, and isms. I think we'd all say amen on that one. And then he talked about, and this is one of the scary verses to me, And I bring it up to my church all the time. Verse 12 should be underlined in your Bible. And this is a scary verse. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. It's different here from where I live. I'm in the, where I live is not only the Bible Belt, it's the buckle of the Bible Belt. In our area, we have 300 Baptist churches. In an area of about 200,000 people in the Tri-Cities. 300 Baptist churches. And there's every kind of church you can name. I don't think it. Even somebody started a Russian Orthodox the other day. A Russian Orthodox church in Bristol, Virginia. Are you kidding me? I didn't know there's any Russian people anywhere around our country. We got a Greek Orthodox. I mean, I don't think there's anything missed in our country when it comes to churches and religions. But you know what? Good, solid, strong churches are not what they were a few years ago all across this country. Some of our great fundamental churches tonight are completely out. The doors, not only the doors closed, they've destroyed the property and they've taken the name Baptist off of the name, my soul. And we have this, and it scares me. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. The falling away, the indifference today to the things of God. Oh, friend, if we could be anything, let's make it a goal and let's walk close to God and let's make sure, if nothing else, we'll be on fire when the Lord comes. There'll be a fire burning in our heart for Jesus. Now I want to zero in on verse 6 a minute. And I believe God gives us a specific beginning of a time period of the time of sorrows, the countdown to the rapture. Nothing has to happen for the rapture to take place. Premillennialism believes in the intimate return of Jesus. Jesus could come at any time, and nothing has to happen for the rapture to take place. And that's the time we're in right now. Verse 6 says, "And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places. All these are the beginning of sorrows." I believe verse 6 and 7 specifically is talking about World War I. Now, there were three things that happened in World War I that's given here in the Bible. The whole entire world came to war the first time in human history. Y'all realize that? You realize there had never been a time that the whole world, there had been wars all through history, but never a time that the whole world came together to fight. There was only a dozen nations on the earth. There was just a handful. I won't give the number if I'm not sure, but just a very small number of nations on the earth when World War I, and it's in the height of the world, by the time the United States came involved in it, there were very few nations not officially involved in World War I. Also about that time, there was the flu epidemic, which killed almost, I forget how many million, took out millions of people. I think 2 million in America died from the flu epidemic. And there was earthquakes, unparalleled earthquakes in different places, in Japan, in South America, that happened right at this time. Now, World War I will mark the beginning of some very important things prophetically for all of the pieces of the puzzle to work together in prophecy. Well, so you've got to remember that concerning the Middle East, when World War I started, none of the prophecies that we study about could possibly have taken place, because there was not an Iran, there was not an Iraq, there was not a Jordan, there was not an Israel, there was not a Lebanon, there was not a Libya, there was not a Saudi Arabia, there was not a Yemen. All of that part of the world was the Ottoman Turk Empire. They were cruel people. There was an officer that fought in the Middle East by the name of Major Lawrence. And he's known in history as Lawrence of Arabia. He did something that had never been done before, and it's never been done since. He's the only man in history to ever get the Arab Bedouins to come together and not fight each other, but fight against somebody. He promised them that if they would fight with the British, that they would be independent. They would have their independent countries. And after the war, he continued to fight for that. And in the 1922 peace conference in Paris, most of the current 22 Arab countries were formed at that time, directly resulting from World War I. So when we read about Iran and Iraq and Syria, you had two mandates. You had the British mandate, the French mandate that established those countries. You read about those things. That was not until World War I that it came about. Number two, the second thing that happened, that's very key to Bible prophecy in World War I. This was the time when Israel officially was given a declaration for the Jews to go back to Israel. The Ottoman Turks also controlled Jerusalem and Israel. And the British defeated the Ottoman Turks. They took control of Jerusalem. And there was a key scientist in England, a Jewish scientist, Cham Wiseman, who invented a way of producing acetone and explosives synthetically, and he saved the British Empire. Winston Churchill was Minister of Defense. He came to Mr. Wiseman and said, "What could England do for you in appreciation? You saved England. Without you, our country would be gone. We would not have been able to defeat the Germans." And he was part of Zionism. The Zionist movement started in 1876 with Hertz. And their statement was, there's a people without a land, and there's a land without a people. Wow. Not only when the Jews were dispersed into other countries did God maintain their identity and kept their bloodlines scattered all over the world and was able to bring them back, but do you realize another thing God did? He said the land will be desolate when the Jews are out of it, and no one was able to go in and cultivate that land and settle that land and go in there and homestead that. The Turks tried to. Right after they took control of it. They took control of the Middle East in 1517, the same year as the Reformation. From 1517 to 1917, the Ottoman Turks ruled the Middle East. And now, because of what this Jewish scientist did, England issued the Balfour Declaration. That's very important to understand in prophetic history. Officially let Jews go back. The third thing World War I did that has a great bearing is it began the formation of the one world government. Woodrow Wilson's brainchild was the League of Nations. And he's the one that came up with the League. Well, some of the globalists around him did, but it's accredited to Woodrow Wilson. But America would not ratify it. And so one of the men that worked for Woodrow Wilson was a communist, and he began and founded the Council on Foreign Relations at that time. But we are now living in the eve of a one world global government made up of 10 unions of the world, the whole world organized into 10 unions. All of this is upon us, folks. That all started in World War I. I believe that began the sorrows. All of these are the beginning of sorrows. And you know what? From that time on, things have progressed and progressed and progressed and progressed until we are now living on the verge of the coming of the Lord. The ability to fulfill prophecies tonight has only been this generation. The whole world to watch the two witnesses in the streets of Jerusalem. It's only been By the way, you say, well, that's on the TV. It's going to be more than the TV. It's going to be the smartphone. We built a church in the Philippines, Brother Jim, back in a mountain. Had to walk 2 hours in a mountain. No electricity. Built a church up there. I've been there twice. Preached in that church. Preached up there twice. It's a blessing. Everybody up there's got a cell phone. They spell poor with six O's. And they got a cell phone. Hey, we put a solar system in the church. And the people come. And I said, I told the pastor, I said, you can have a double charge campaign. Come and charge your soul and charge your phone. Amen. The solar system. That's amazing to me. Cell phones. Almost in a tribal community in the Philippines. The whole world will watch those witnesses. Hey, the ability in Revelation 13 for the Antichrist to control the finances of every individual on earth. All that technology is here today. We have it. Listen, a cashless society. They're bankrupting us right now on purpose. The next goal for this nation is to finalize the North American Union made up of the United States and Canada. The first goal is to issue not United States or Canadian passports, but North American Union passports. By the way, has anybody been flown international in the last 2 years? Anybody been overseas and come back home? Canada and United States together now. Did you notice that? Huh? 2 years ago when I went to the Philippines, came back to Atlanta, United States and Canada, foreigners. Used the word foreigners. I come home from Guyana back last month, United States and Canada, foreign is not seen now. Global entry. Global entry. Everything's global now. They will not use, our government will not use the word foreign or alien now. It is removed from all documentation. Friend, we're so close to the coming of the Lord, it's unreal tonight. Amen. I mean, this saying is moving fast, friend. And it's exciting because we are watching these things unfold. Amen. And so we have the birth pains. And so many things I could say about that. But the social prophecies of the days of Lot and the days of Noah, we spent a long time on tonight as we watch things unfold, the violence upon our earth. Jesus told us that our day would be like the days of Noah and the days of Lot. I'm telling you, the Lord is coming. Amen. We see the explanation, the events. Thirdly, the expectation for the rapture. Now, I'm not going to spend much time here, but seven times in the Bible, and get your concordance down and look it up, but you'll find seven times that the rapture is compared to the coming of a thief. As a thief comes. Why is that? Because no one that ever got robbed was expecting that thief to come. If you know the thief's coming, you're waiting on him with a shotgun. Right? And so you have that. Now I'm going to deal with that material tonight because I've got some other interesting things that I want to give you and deal with. Number four, we've looked at the explanation, the events leading up to the rapture, the expectation of the rapture. Fourthly, I want us to consider examples in the Bible of the rapture. Now some of this will blow your mind, but stay with me tonight and I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll preach a few more minutes. Amen. Praise God. Everybody okay? Is everybody? It's been, how long have I been going? I don't know. But how many will let me preach 5 more minutes? Hold your hand up. Leave it up. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50. I'm good. All right. Tricked you, didn't I? Amen. Now, let me give you this real quickly. First example of the rapture is Enoch. You remember Enoch was in the days of Noah. And he teaches us the who of the rapture. Because the Bible said Enoch walked with God and he was not, because God took him. Enoch had this testimony in Hebrews 11 that he pleased God. Wow, I want that, don't you? And without faith, it's in Hebrews 11, 6. And without faith, what? It is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Enoch teaches us the who of the rapture. Oh, Brother Mays Jackson. Now, he was one of those hackers. I don't know if any of y'all ever remember Brother Mays. I miss him so much. Brother Mays said, Mr., he said, the Americans sent a man in space, and they called him an astronaut. And then he said the Russians sent a man in space, and they called him a cosmonaut. But Enoch was not. Amen. Because God took him. I love that. Amen. The second, now go to 2 Peter chapter 2. The second example of the rapture is Lot. He is a wild example. He's sure not a good example of a Christian. Amen. Unless you use him as a negative example. In 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 7, we read a little bit about Mr. Lot. Now, Lot was the nephew of Abraham. And you remember that because of their cattle, that their herdsmen had a problem. So Abraham said, now you want to go to the right, I'll go left. You want to go left, I'll go right. You choose, the land's before you. And he chose the well-watered plains of Sodom and Gomorrah for his cattle. He'll end up moving into that place and getting involved in the politics of that place until the Lord Jesus and two angels, when they leave Abraham, they will go down and the two angels will go proceed into Sodom and Gomorrah. And Lot will try to impress them not to stay in the streets because he knows how wicked that place is. And he presses them to come home with him. And when he does, you know what happens? Those men of that city come and they almost tear down the door. He offers them his daughters. And they had to strike those Sodomites with blindness. And Lot says, you get your family, you get ready and get out of this place. Now, the Bible tells us here in 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 7, and delivered just Lot, he's talking about verse 6, turning Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes now, and delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked, for that righteous man dwelling among them in seeing and hearing vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful or perverted deeds. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptation and to reserve the unjust until the day of judgment to be punished. Lot, you remember the story, folks? They literally had to take hold of him and pull him out of there. Wow. And when Lot got free of Sodom and Gomorrah, what did God do? He destroyed that place, set judgment on that place. But he could not do that as long as Lot was there. And we have a lot of this doctrine of mid-trib rapture, pre-wrath rapture. This has really got popular in a lot of fundamental circles. The church is going through the tribulation. You better start putting you back and buying survival food and become a survivalist and find you a place out in Oregon somewhere or Idaho or something like that. And man, have you some stuff buried in a cave and be a survivalist, because we're going through half of the tribulation. Well, there's nothing wrong with being prepared for bad times. They may come without the rapture taking place. But if you think the church is going through the day of the Lord, the judgment that comes after the rapture, there's no way. Because God cannot judge this world till he takes us out first. God is a just God. He does what's right. Amen. We are ambassadors. An ambassador is not left in a place that they attack. They get any nation before, well, most any nation, Japan didn't do it, but most all nations get their ambassadors home before hostilities take place. Lot teaches us the why of the rapture. We have to be removed so that God can deal with this world. The third example of the rapture is Elijah. And he is the example of the how of the rapture. Will you agree with me that God took him to heaven in a chariot of fire? How many agree that God did that? You have a problem with that? I take we'd all agree on that, wouldn't you? Huh? Let me ask you something. If the Lord chose to take us to heaven in a chariot, would that be all right with you? Huh? Praise God. I think he's going to. I really do. I think he is the how of the rapture. Let's go over there and look at Elijah just for a moment. And I'm going to preach to 8:30, okay? I've got a clock back here, and I'm watching it. Amen. I don't mind you looking at your watch. I'd ask you not to take it off and shake it, please. Amen. Not go with me to 2 Kings chapter 2. Praise the Lord. Oh, I love it. I tell you, folks, my wife will say, don't get him started on prophecy. We got to go. Oh, I love it. Oh, I love it. 2 Kings chapter 2. Now, here is one of the great, all-time great prophets of the Bible. And he's one of three men in the Old Testament that went to heaven, that God took to heaven. Elijah, Enoch, and Moses. Amen? You say, where do you get that God took Moses to heaven? All the other Old Testament saints went to Abraham's bosom. Those three went to heaven. We know God took Moses to heaven because he's with Elijah on the Mount of Transfiguration. Amen. Did you know that the tomb of Aaron is highly guarded by the Muslims and it's very few people's ever seen it? But there is a tomb to Aaron. But no one knows where Moses' grave is. And the book of Jude says there was a dispute over the body of Moses between Michael the archangel and Satan. And he told the devil, the Lord rebuke thee. And when we see Moses and Elijah on the Mount of Transfiguration, always remember that Elijah represents the resurrected saints. Moses represents the resurrected saints. And Elijah represents those who were glorified without death, because Elijah did not die. He was changed. And by the way, folks, Enoch, Elijah, and Moses have been glorified. They can none of them be the two witnesses of Revelation 11. We need to use a little bit of common sense. God did give us a brain to use, didn't he? Huh? Amen? A glorified person can't die. Jesus can't die. He's glorified. When we're glorified, we'll never die. It's an impossibility for a glorified person to die. You said, and the Bible never said it was any of those men. Did it? Amen. You're looking at me like a calf looking at a new gate, but that's all right, praise God. I'm going to preach anyhow. Huh? We don't know who they are. The Bible doesn't say who they are. One commentary I was reading said, they came from heaven. I said, where does the Bible say that? I went back and read the whole chapter. Read it three times to try to find where there was a reference in Revelation 11 that those two men came from heaven. There's nothing about them coming from heaven. I believe there'll be two of the 144,000 men that God will use in that day. We don't know who they are, but they're going to be men that can die, and then God will resurrect them after they die. It's another sermon tonight. And I just killed five more minutes of my time. Now, in 2 Kings chapter 2. By the way, if you'll read, go home tonight and read Acts 1:11 and Luke 24:50-51, you'll find out something interesting about the ascension of Jesus. That Jesus did not fly to heaven, but he was carried to heaven. You ever study it? Amen? He didn't go out like Superman. That's what we think of, isn't it? That's the picture the artist drew, him levitating. You read it now, it says very clearly that he was taken from them, he was carried. Now, he didn't ride piggyback. King of kings and the Lord of lords would not be manhandled by anyone. The only means that would be acceptable for to carry Jesus would have been one of the heavenly royal chariots, one of the limousines of glory to carry him to heaven. Now, Elijah went to heaven in a chariot. Amen. In 2 Kings 2:11, the Bible tells us this. Again, also, he sent unto them, not in the verse I want, 17, I'm sorry, verse 17. So, well, wait a minute. Let me find what I want to show you. 2 Kings chapter 2, all right, verse 14, I'm sorry. Behold, there came fire down from heaven. Am I in the rapture? I'm in chapter 1. No wonder that's not working. All right. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Be like that fellow, that old preacher, he glued his pages together, you know, and he's reading about Noah's wife, and she is 60 cubits wide and all that. He turned the page, and he said, I'll tell you, there's some things hard to believe in this Bible, he said. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. Okay. Let's look at verse 11, chapter 2. Okay. And it came to pass, as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a what? Whirlwind unto heaven. I think what I'm going to do is, I think I'm going to finish this message tomorrow night, if that's okay. And I want you to see about these chariots. And I want you to help me, because I welcome any help, if you can explain what all of these chariots are doing. By the way, think about this tonight. The only people in Christendom, in the history of Christendom, that ever picked up on the chariots were the black slaves in the days of slavery. Who sung what? Swing low, sweet what? Chariot. Coming for to carry me home. Wow. They got it. They caught it. Huh? And they didn't make that up. They read that in the Word of God. Amen. Well, it's good to be saved. Amen. We are at the verge of some big things taking place in this world. Amen. I don't know what's going to happen. This is going to be a pivotal year. It is going to be... I just don't know. I don't know what's going to take place. But I know this. We're in His hands, if you're saved. And He's got everything in control tonight. Amen? Now, that doesn't mean we're supposed to become fatalistic and lay down. Okay, no. We're to pray and witness and work and give and study the Bible with everything we've got. In fact, the Bible says that we're to provoke into one another love and good works, and we're not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together as the manner some is. Amen. But rather so much the more as you see what? You know that, don't you? As you see what now? The day approaching. The writer of Hebrews, I believe it was Paul, said, you're going to be able to see that day approaching. And instead of laying out, instead of cutting out services, instead of going soft and going liberal, it ought to be so much the more as we see the day approaching. He's coming, amen? Amen. The Lord is coming. Let's bow our heads tonight. God bless each one of you. Thank you for being here. What if the rapture would take place tonight? What if the Lord would give that shout, that trumpet would sound, the voice of the archangel, the dead in Christ would rise first? We're going to see tomorrow night that when the rapture takes place, that one of the things about it is, it'll be too late for you to turn back to your family, to your loved ones, to your friends, and warn them and talk to them. There'll not be time for that. The time for that is now. And seeing that the day is at hand, seeing that the day is far spent, the night is at hand, let us lay off the works, lay aside the works of darkness. He said in Romans 13. I wonder tonight how many could raise their hand and say, preacher, thank God I'm rapture ready. And if the Lord would come tonight, or before we could get out of this building, the rapture would take place. I'll meet you in the rapture. How many could raise their hand and say, thank God I'll meet you in the rapture. I'm rapture ready. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. I believe every hand's raised. Thank you. You can put them down. God bless you. I'm so glad. Is there anybody that couldn't raise their hand tonight? And you are concerned about your soul. I didn't see you raise it. I didn't notice you. Brother Dewey, I'm not sure myself. I'd like to be. Pray for me. Anyone like that? Anyone like that? Now, how many would say tonight by lifting hand, preacher, I've got some precious loved ones and friends that are not rapture ready. I want to see them saved. How many would raise your hand and say, I've got loved ones and friends that are not rapture ready. Again, every hand raised, every hand brought up. Oh my, tonight. You know what? The Bible says that God, if we'll humble ourselves, God will, He will revive our hearts. He'll revive the heart of the humble and revive the spirit of the contrite. Father, bless the invitation tonight. Thank you for the good start of the meeting, good liberty to preach. And Lord, we come here and it's very easy to preach in this place. And we know there's a wonderful man of God who preaches the Bible to his people. And thank you for that, God. Bless this meeting. I pray we'll get excited about this meeting this week and what is going to be preached and said. Folks will get folks here tomorrow night that aren't saved. That would be wonderful, Lord. And Father, we're going to thank you now and praise you for what you do. For we pray in Jesus' name. Let's stand together and let's have a invitation tonight, and listen, it'd be a good way to start the revival if all that would maybe come around the altars and pray and call the names out tonight of those precious loved ones that moms and dads, husbands and wives, sons and daughters, brothers and sisters, think about that, aunts and uncles, loved ones, friends and neighbors that aren't saved, that you care about, that you love very dearly. You ought to come tonight. Maybe you need to draw closer to God yourself. But let's come tonight around the altars and all that will as we sing. And who's, you going to lead us in a song, Brother Jim? All right, she's just going to play on the instrument. And all that will tonight, would you come and make your way around these altars and let's pray and get this meeting started out tonight. Carrying a burden that... carrying our burdens to Him tonight. Come right on. God bless you. Come right on. That's right. And God's people are coming tonight. Let me ask you this. Could you be closer to God than you are? Could you draw closer to Him tonight than you are? I believe we could. Amen. Just come right on. If you can't kneel, you can come and sit. That's fine. But let's make our way up here. Let's come tonight. The Bible said, if my people which are called by my name should humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin, and I'll heal their land. Oh, I'm glad tonight for those promises. Thank God for them tonight.